Father's Day. And I'm really glad that at First Christian Church we kind of make a big deal of it. We have pie and ice cream and whipped cream. Yum, pie. People don't always seem to make a big deal of Father's Day. Mother's Day, yes. But Father's Day, not so much. Well, advertisers make a big deal of it. Power tools, gardening stuff, barbecues, a new car. I even saw an ad that suggested it would be a good idea to buy Dad a new vacuum cleaner. I thought that was a little odd, but you know, some fathers clean. Maybe. Maybe. Anyway, it occurred to me this morning on my way in that in my childhood home, we mistreated my father pretty badly. Every Father's Day, we would present him with his annual gifts of shirts, ties, and handkerchiefs or whatever. And then we would send him outside to burn meat. Yes, that's right. On Mother's Day, everybody dresses up, goes out for a wonderfully special dinner at a restaurant. And Dad gets sent outside to cook his own dinner while we popped outside from time to time asking if it was ready yet. Although luckily for Daddy, Pennsylvania in mid-June never got as hot as Fresno is going to be today. 108? That's crazy. But you know, sometimes when I'm sitting with a family talking about their father's funeral service, I hear them say things like, well, he wasn't anybody special, really. You know, he went to work every day, he supported us all, he encouraged us in our endeavors. He was an ordinary guy, he just did the best he could. He was just Dad. And when I hear that, I always know which scripture passage I'm going to preach from. It's kind of unrecognized, like Father's Day. I mean, we all know the one from Proverbs about the capable wife who's worth rubies and gold and all those things. We frequently pull that one out on Mother's Day. But there's one in the book of Sirach, which is in the Apocrypha, that speaks about fathers like these, ordinary guys. It begins by talking about famous people. Let us now sing the praises of famous men, our ancestors in their generations. The Lord apportioned to them great glory, his majesty from the beginning. These were those who ruled in their kingdoms and made a name for themselves by their valor. These were those who gave counsel because they were wise, those who spoke in prophetic oracles, those who led the people by their counsels and by their knowledge of the people's lore. They were wise in their words of instruction, those who composed musical tunes or put verses in writing, rich men endowed with resources, living peacefully in their homes. All of these were honored in their generations and were given pride in their time. Some of them have left behind a name so that others might declare their praise. And then the writer got to the important part. But of others there is no memory. They've perished as though they never existed. They become as though they were never born. They and their children after them. But these were godly men whose righteous deeds have not been forgotten. Their wealth will remain with their descendants and their inheritance with their children. Their descendants stand by the covenants and their children also for their sake. Their offspring will continue forever and their glory will never be blotted out. Their bodies are buried in peace, but their name lives on generation after generation. The assembly declares their wisdom and the congregation proclaims their praise. These were the ordinary guys. The fathers who never got famous, never sought glory, just did what they did, raising their families to the best of their ability. No one would celebrate them as historical figures or great leaders. Their names aren't on any buildings or in historical documents, except maybe census reports. But they are all so special, because they raised up families who went on to raise up families caring for each other and loving God, doing the best they could with whatever they had. Kind of nobodies, really, in the eyes of the world, but so very special to their families. Kind of like the disciples. You know, Jesus could have picked rabbis and Pharisees to be his disciples. He could have picked people who were steeped in the law and in the traditions of temple worship. He could have picked men who had spent their formative years sitting at the feet of their rabbi, learning the Hebrew of scholars, memorizing the scrolls of the law and the prophets. He could have had the cream of the academic crop, masters in their field, top theologians and lawyers of his time. For that matter, God could have had Jesus born into a wealthy and powerful family. He could have had access to the finest education available and had name recognition just by virtue of who he was born to. He could have grown up in the seats of power so he wouldn't have appeared a threat to the powers that be. He would have been one of them. He would have known how to play those games of politics and power. But that's not who God wanted. God wanted his word to be brought by an ordinary man. So Jesus was born into the family of a carpenter, a man who worked with his hands. Not quite at the bottom of the social scale, but pretty close. And these other guys, these 12 guys that Jesus selected to hear his message first, and then go out and proclaim the good news, you know, the God he picked instead of the rich and the famous. Who were those guys? Really? Okay, so Simon, Peter, and Andrew were brothers, and they were fishermen. We know that. Maybe they owned their own boat, maybe not. Maybe they worked for somebody else. Scripture doesn't really tell us that. We do know that Simon was married because Jesus healed his mother-in-law, who then fixed dinner for him. It says it in the Bible. It must have happened. But we really don't know much more about those two except those few facts. James and John were also fishermen, and they worked on their father Zebedee's boat. We don't know anything from Scripture about Philip and Bartholomew. In the Gospel according to Matthew, we're told that the disciple named Matthew was a tax collector, although neither Mark nor Luke say anything about his occupation. Tax collectors were seriously at the bottom of the social scale. They worked for the Romans. They were widely reputed to be greedy and dishonest. Nobody liked tax collectors. Thomas is sometimes called the twin in John's gospel, but none of the other three gospels say anything descriptive about him at all. He's just Thomas. The second James we encounter on the list of disciples is known as James, son of Alphaeus. The second Simon is known as the Canaan in Matthew and Mark, and as the Zealot in Luke, which means he was an anti-Rome activist, probably with a violent past, and who may or may not have been the one that pulled the sword in the Garden of Gethsemane when Jesus was arrested. Matthew and Mark both include the name of Thaddeus, another unknown person. While Luke doesn't mention that name at all, but in his place names Judas, son of James. The last of the 12, of course, is Judas Iscariot on all three lists. Matthew tells us this is the one who would betray Jesus. Iscariot, by the way, means man of Kerioth, which is a city in the south of Judea. So he's named just for the place he came from. Now, when we consider these 12 men, they're pretty much nobodies. And not just nobodies, but nobodies at the bottom of the social structure, a step or two above slaves and women. No one would automatically give these men respect or defer to their opinions. They weren't particularly well educated. Most were presumably from Galilee, which, according to Alan Callahan, associate professor of New Testament at Harvard Divinity School, was historically known as a contested region, populated by a mix of cultures, a hotbed of political unrest and activity. It was, reputedly, a place that seemed to breed would-be messiahs and bandits of the Robin Hood variety. Periodically, Rome would have to step in and clear out yet another nest of unrest. Hence the question in John 1:46, can anything good come out of Nazareth? So again, who were these guys? These were the right guys. These were the guys selected by God. For just as God had Jesus born into the family of a man who worked with his hands and came from an area with a questionable reputation, so were his followers chosen from ordinary folks. The message is what is important, not the person carrying it. Because Jesus told those 12 men, "Go to the lost sheep of the house of Israel, not to the righteous people who are already doing God's will, and not to the people who have funds and ready access to the temple for healing there, or those who could afford a physician. But go to the poor, the needy, the sick, the desperate. Go to the ones who felt abandoned, who felt like they had no place to turn." He told them, in fact, to go and find the very same sorts of people he was drawing to himself, and to take and heal them, and comfort them, to cast out their demons and tell them that the kingdom of God is near. And quite frankly, those folks, those poor, desperate folks, didn't really need some famous rich guy to come in and wave help around. Probably wouldn't have trusted them anyway. If there had been such a thing as a photo op. They needed to know that these were people who were just like them. People who didn't have a great name or a great fortune or a great education, who were just there to help, because that's what God requires. They needed to know that these people had nothing to gain from the gifts of healing they brought, and they sought nothing in return for their healing and their preaching. Those of you who pay attention to social media may have noticed that 3 days ago the interwebs exploded with a story of Jeff Bezos, who is the founder and CEO of Amazon. And it seems this man, who's worth something like $80 billion, yes, that was billion with a B, was called out by the New York Times about his charitable giving. They didn't know who he gave money to or how much. Terrible, because it seems if you're rich and famous, we have to know exactly how much money you give to charity and who it's for. You know, he declined to answer the New York Times questions about his charitable giving. Instead, he asked all 259,000 of his followers on Twitter where he should give his money. He wanted to find a way to help people right now. Not some foundation that'll give it out in bits and pieces over the next several decades, but some place where his money could go to work helping actual humans right now, this minute. A very good idea, actually, for somebody with a lot of funds. Actually, a very cool idea for everybody. Where is their immediate need? We asked that question in Bible study on Wednesday. Where is their immediate need that we can just give money to right now? How can I put my money, my time, my talents to use taking care of that immediate need? One way or the other, what I do with my little bits of money. But my $2 here and $5 there and $25 over there, added together with your $2 and your $5 and your $25 and yours and yours and yours, that makes a difference. Right now. So who are these guys? They're just ordinary guys. Like all those ordinary dads. People like us. Nobodies, sort of. Not that anybody's really a nobody, because we're all somebody and we're all important. But you know, Jesus kept telling people that the last would be first, and that those who would lead must first serve. Jesus selected ordinary folks to do his work then and now. Because we are the ones who were selected to do his work now. We are the ones sent out into the world as Jesus' disciples to tell the nations the good news that God's kingdom is at hand. We are the ones who are sent out as Jesus' disciples to cast out the demons of oppression and hatred, to comfort the comfortless, to feed the hungry in body and in spirit. So go. Be like Bartholomew and Philip and Thaddeus. Lay your hand on somebody who just needs to know the healing touch of a person who cares. Speak words of peace and comfort to somebody who's suffering pain and sorrow. Be the good news of God's love. Just like those guys. Those guys. The ones that Jesus gathered to himself and sent out into the world. Amen. Now, all of us are those guys. But if you're one of those guys who has not yet been baptized and wish to do so, or if you are looking for a church home and want to make this that